Okay, let's get started. Give people with the laptops to do that, please. So I wasn't planning to make a presentation today, but I was going to do the reviews, and that's sort of why only half of roughly half you received feedback from me. And I realized that there were a couple of misunderstandings or a couple of things that it would make sense for me to just make a brief presentation before the class and clear a few things up. So I'm going to cover two things. I'm going to cover templates, matrices, and one-by-one convolutions. That dreaded term that I hate, but I want to cover these two just so that I want to make sure we're all on the same page. So a doublet matrix. Who knows here what a doublet matrix is? What's a doublet matrix?
Like it's like you put patches on the diagonal of the matrix and then it just becomes a normal matrix multiplied?
Yeah, so he's getting ahead of us. So this is a doublet matrix. It's a matrix where the diagonals are constant. So any diagonal you take, so you know the main diagonal has all A's on it, the off diagonal, you know, plus one has all B's on it, the C's, the D's, and B's. It also just means that I can express, this is the same way of expressing it, it's just that distance from the main diagonal is all that you care about, right? Aij is basically A of I minus B. That's what the doublet matrix is. Alright, so, but we are not mathematicians, there are some elegant properties. These matrices only have 2n minus 1 free parameters, not n squared, which means that linear systems are easy to solve at home. But why do we care? Machine learning people. Why do we care about doublet matrices? And Michael gave you a hint. Why should we care? Convolutions as matrix multiplications, exactly. So if you think of a convolution between a signal x and a filter h, if you just do this right trick where you write your x as a column vector, you take h and you sort of start sliding it across and you're copying bits and pieces and chopping across. So h1 is just, this is discrete convolution, right? Or discrete correlation, cross-correlation for now, but we're not doing the flipping trick. So the h1 enters, they're all zeros, then h1, h2 enters, then h1, h2, h3 enters, and so on. So the rows of this matrix have that signal, have that filter passing through and getting chopped, right? So that, this is a doublet matrix by construction. This is exactly the illustration of this concept, right? Every time I put a filter down and I'm sort of strolling across, that is a row. It doesn't start till here when the intersection starts. So that's a row in this matrix. Does that make sense? Is that clear? So there's a signal, which is your column vector. There's a row here. Dot product gives you an entry in Y, which is also a column vector. It gives you what the convolution output should be at that point, or cross-correlation output. So first of all, you can actually write it in two ways. You can take your data and put the filters on the rows, or you can put the filter once and do the same trick with the data. It's a symmetric operation, doesn't really matter. You can do either one. But the key thing is, why do we care? We care because this is the precise mathematical statement of saying that a convolution output, this is for 1D, you can do similar tricks for 2D, that a convolution output is a matrix multiplication times the input. Right, and that's an extremely important statement because in a number of papers that you've read today and that you're going to read, sometimes people will say that they have convolution layers stacked together, but they will not say that there's a non-linearity between them. Right, and it's extremely important for you to realize that even though they're not saying it, those exist because otherwise this would be a meaningless operation to put three convolution layers back to back to you. Because of this, exactly this, right? You cannot have matrices being multiplied against each other, you might as well just have a single convolution. Does that make sense? Any questions about that? Okay, so that was point one. The next thing that I want to clarify is this ugly thing of one-by-one convolution, right? Okay, so we've covered this issue a couple of times. We've reached this a couple of times. Well, generally there is this trend, right? You take a convolution neural network, there are multiple feature maps, there are multiple sort of convolutions, non-linearities, maybe a max pooling, some layers. At some point, usually you've seen in these architectures, what's happening is that the third dimension is increasing in size, the spatial resolution is decreasing in size, either because of the spine or because you're doing a max pooling. Right? At some point, the spatial resolution becomes small enough that it becomes something like 5x5, 7x7, whatever, depending on the architecture. And at some point they say, you know, this is followed by a fully connected layer. So you sort of take these all maps, string them up into a long vector, and then you just have fully connected layers. And that's one way of thinking about it. So this is one sort of separation that people have made that this is a feature extraction stage and this is a classification stage, right? There's a fully connected stage. But those that is just one way of thinking about it, and it's not necessarily the case that we should stick to this thinking. Because if we do, then inelegant and inefficient things happen. Because, for example, we're going to see this paper, and it's not inelegant, but in its implementation, it is inefficient. Because what this paper does is, you want to run this convolutional neural network on multiple patches or multiple rectangles from the input window. You take each one of them out, rescale to a fixed size bounding box, and then rerun your convolutional neural network on the whole thing. Right. Why is this inefficient?
We need to do that for all the many overlapping.
So the key thing that's happening here is if you think about what a convolution is, it goes over the whole thing, it gives you an output feature map. You don't need to run your network multiple times on multiple patches. You can share a lot of computation because if these bounding boxes never overlapped, then that's fine. You haven't lost anything. But if these bounding boxes overlap, you're going over those same regions many, many times. Right? So ideally what you'd like is to sort of somehow be able to think of this as just a fully, this is a phrase that is also odd because it's fully convolutional neural network, right? Something in which all the layers are convolutional, which means that if this image was not 227 by 227, it was something larger, we could still run a convolution on that larger image, right? Just the output size will depend on the input size. So different training samples will produce different outputs. If this was a fully convolutional neural network. So for example, if the image was somewhat larger, it was not 224 by 224, you know, this thing, because it has maybe a style 4, it's producing H by 4, W by 4. Right? It was just subsample this, all your layers are sort of subsampling, but ultimately you're producing something which depends on the input size. So if we can do that, we're good, and we can produce output maps. And this is an idea that you've met today, for example, in the VGG paper. They actually talk about running this on the entire thing. That similar idea also exists in network and network. But here's how to think about that idea in terms of change. So here's how I want you to think about this idea. So recall that when we wrote down a convolutional neural network, we said, you know, we drew this in the third dimension. Each one of this is a feature map. So there's some height by width. Let's assume this is sort of the last convolutional layer, and this is sort of the start of the first fully connected layer. So this is in notation of AlexNet, this would be FC5, right? So there are C5 of these, there are FC6, thank you, C6 of these, and then it's followed by another fully connected layer, and so there's C7 of these feature maps. And the way you've been asked to think about this is, you know, we know how fully connected layers work. Every neuron looks at, you know, this is a scalar, every neuron looks at every other scalar, does a weighted some summation of weight times activation to get this activation. It's this one that we've been having trouble thinking about, right? What is this, you know, one way of thinking about this is, if I need a scalar, then I need to sort of somehow convert, one way of sort of thinking about this is I can, if this is one feature map, I can write down a vector, and I can take row by row concatenation of that first feature map, put it here. If this is the next feature map, I can take row by row concatenation of that, put it here. Concatenate all these feature maps across C5. Do an inner product of that with a weight. So W, so if I want to produce at the ith one, I would call this Wi my vector, which is of the same dimensionality as, if this is, let's say, n by C5, right? That's how long this vector is. Then that's how long each of these Wi is. Usually this is where most of the parameters in the convolutional neural network live. Right? This is usually something like 7 by 7 times some 1,000 or 4,000, whatever this is, right? That's where most of the vectors are. That's one way of thinking about it. But another way of thinking about this is also to think about this same thing as an inner product between two 3D volumes. So your original data volume, inner product with a weight volume. So this is your original H. This whole thing was H5. This whole thing is H6. This whole thing is H7. And so what we're basically saying is this is H5, and these are all the weights. This is the weight at the ith neuron. It's a 3D volume, because you can take this vector and you can reshape it according to this 3D. It has one entry for every dimension of the data. Does that make sense? Why do we care whether we think of this as a reshaped inner product or a strung out inner product? Why should this matter? Inner products are inner products, so you get a scalar back.
That would mean like this. That would happen in the convolutional layer as opposed to in a fully connected layer. You usually string them up.
Almost. Once we think of it as a filter, you know, this is a n by c5 filter. It means that the input can be arbitrary sized, right? It means that I just have to hold this to a fixed size. My model has these numbers encoded in it. The input does not have to be a fixed size. It means if the input was not n by n, but 2n by 2n, I can still run this n by n convolutional output to give you a feature map with stride 1, with padding, you can get n by, you know, whatever, 2n by 2n output. Does that make sense? So this is why it's important to think of this layer. You can think of it both as a convolutional layer or as a fully connected layer. And in fact, you know, this thing is a fully connected layer, right? It just has some scalars. Dot product with a vector to give you another vector. You can think of this operation also as convolutional, right? Because I can take this thing, I can also write this as an inner product of 1 by 1 by... This is an extremely narrow volume. It's 1 by 1 by C5, or C6. And this weight is also 1 by 1 by... All of these weights on these edges, I can write them in the third dimension like this. And as soon as I think of this as a three-dimensional filter, it means that if these things are not scalars at every neuron, if these things are also feature maps of some size, it means I can run a one-by-one convolution, if you will. It's a three-dimensional object, so if you think about this, what does one-by-one convolution mean or a 2D convolution? It just means you take your input, you scale it by some number, so there's C6 of those. Each one empty in the third dimension is a scalar, right? You just multiply this map by a scalar and you add these things up. Does that make sense? So these feature maps are linear combinations of these feature maps, which is exactly what we've been doing all along in neural networks, right? You take some hidden activations, you take linear combinations. Whether those hidden activations are scalars or 2D maps doesn't really matter. Does that make sense? Okay. Any questions about this? Yes?
So, between the two fully connected layers, it's easy for me to understand this. But when you have, let's say, an n by n score map, and we are trying to make it into a fully connected layer, there we are saying that the filter is actually n by n.
Exactly.
That is an n by n.
Exactly. The filter is an n by n filter, n by n by C5, if you want to think of it in the third dimension. Yes. Because the filter is the same size as the original input, it does not need to move around. You just put it at one location, you get one number back. And this also means that in AlexNet or existing networks, you can take those fully connected layers, you can reshape them, and you can view them as convolutional filters, right? So we could have just gone back and run them on arbitrary size inputs. Right? Does that make sense? And in fact, the VGG paper talks about the difference between taking a crop and running it through the network and doing this fully convolutional stuff. The difference is boundary conditions. When you take a crop, you pad it with zero. when you actually run it on the full network, you're actually copying in values from the original image. You're not padding it. Does that make sense?
Actually, I didn't get that point in the paper. The difference between copying versus...
So this is an image, and this is a random window.
Okay.
You crop it out, and then you run a convolutional neural network. If you
Which convolutional neural network?
AlexNet, let's say.
Okay.
If you crop it out and then you feed it into a convnet, you're going to have to zero pad it,
okay.
Right? But if you run the convnet on the entire image, right? So you run conv1, conv2 on the entire image, these boundaries are not zero padded. They're actual pixel values that are playing.
But zero padding versus not is just a choice, right? Like, why do I have to do it for cropping?
Let's assume for now that it's not that you have to do it for cropping. It's that if you want to, if your architecture is maintaining the same size of inputs, let's say, right, then it's doing zero padding.
Okay.
Otherwise, the thing is shrinking.
So even for your NYN inputs that you would have struggled to get connected, you would have chosen the zero pad.
Right.
But what if you just set a base to a filter and gotten
an
NYN size back? It's just that you didn't want
that. You didn't want that, yeah. Yeah, you could think of this NYN, like maybe I do a lot of zero padding and I move this around. So this output will not be a 1x1x C6. It'll be larger, but it's just that you wanted to write this down as a full unit. So you didn't. Does that make sense?
I have another doubt.
Yes.
I have this filter, and each filter is being applied across all the channels in the input. Right?
So are we talking about this ith at the first?
Just like in between the two fully connected layers,
right.
I take one filter, and so a 1x1 convolution filter is a linear combination of the pixel outputs, all in that position.
Yep,
right.
Exactly.
And so I am multiplying this particular filter with each
of the feature
of
channels.
Feature channels.
And
but it's a different scalar that's with each feature channel. It's a different filter, a different 1x1 filter.
So let's say we want to produce the jth guy here, right? It's looking at some pixels here, and the weights that you're summing up on this edge are different from the weights that you're summing up on. Right? The weights depend on, there is one set of, so 1x1x C5, there's as many of these as C6. Right? 1x1x C6, there's as many of these as C7. Does that make sense? In any layer, there are number of input channels times number of output channels times filter size by filter size, number of weights. And you can view that as a 4D blob, or you can view that as a collection of 3D filters. Or you can view them as a long collection of a fully connected sort of, you know, we draw multi-layer perceptrons with like edges, C1 edges times C2 edges. Every edge is a 2D. Too many ways of thinking about it. Maybe I'm confusing.
So there's a channel, feature channel, and I have one.
Yeah.
Right? So let's not consider the entire rectangle. I'm just considering one neuron, one filter,
one output neuron.
Yes.
Okay.
Like one output feature map.
Okay.
Right. And to get that, I add a linear combination of all the
input. Yes.
Of all the input neurons.
Yeah.
And that is one by one convolution, which gave me one feature map.
I would rather call this 1x1 by C input convolutions, right? Because mathematically precise way of saying 1x1 convolution is just you take your input and you scale it up by a scalar.
So it is a 1x1 by C
exactly.
Convolution, and that gave me one feature.
Yeah.
So if you had
C2. So when AlexNet produces a 4096 vector, each one of the entries in that requires a 1x1 by whatever number of channels in the previous layer. That makes sense. Yes?
Sorry. What was your reason behind not viewing the non-FC connected layers as this and not viewing it as those, but viewing it as this? Essentially both are the same, right? But like,
they're both the same. But if you view it as convolutional, then you can have arbitrary sized inputs.
Okay.
In that case, the weight vector was fixed size.
Weight vectors are always fixed size, but if you view them as this, then the input also has to line up. The input has to be exactly this size, otherwise you can't take the inner product. This is something that, you know, if this one is not n by n, and this is larger, then this just becomes a convolution operation.
Right. But then it won't stay 1 by 1. C6 convolution, then there'll be stripes if this
becomes. Exactly. Then the next, but the next one can still be 1 by 1, right? It's just if your original input is scaled up, your output will not be a 1 by 1 by C, it'll just be some actual N by N by C, right? So you'll get a feature map. So if your network was trained expecting 227 by 227 and you feed it twice of that, the output is not going to be 1 by 1 by 1,000, where we have 1,000 categories. It's going to be twice, like 2N, or let's say some 2H by whatever you're expecting by 1,000. So you get a feature map. And if you read the network and network paper, at the very end, they have visualizations of what those feature maps look like. Like, they're extremely small feature maps that come out, and you can, every entry of them is sort of a score. At this pixel, how much do you believe this category exists?
And so the previous convolution is also an N by N by C convolution.
Previous convolution?
So the 1 by 1 convolution we just discussed is a one, is actually a, it act, so one convolution actually has 1 by 1, 1, 1 into 1 into C parameters.
Yes.
And so even at a previous layer.
Exactly. It was filter size by filter size by number of input channels.
It just seems odd. We have that. So what's going to happen is, let's say we have some input. So we're doing, let's say we break up the input. So it's W1 transpose X plus W2 transpose X. So let's say we just have one filter that we applied first on one image, then we applied it on one previous score map, then on another score map. And now this seems, when you add parameters for each channel, it seems we are doing some constant, we are just adding some constant, we are scaling each filter's response.
But you're not using the same filter on two different feature maps, those two filters are different. And that's why it's 1 by 1 by C, those C values are different.
Exactly.
Which is why, that's what you get in the
nearer
product. You
have
a W vector,
and
a W vector is
the system. And that is what I was trying to see, whether the single product actually factorizes into it. Yeah.
Okay. Any other questions? Yes, should you? Alright, so product operation, right? It doesn't matter that this is a vector space. It's not a regular R D space. It's like R D 1 by D 2 by D 3, but it doesn't matter, right? Inner products are inner products. You can write down linearity of inner products. Like, as soon as you have inner products, you have all the properties of an inner product space. The other thing is efficiency. We already talked about this. You don't need to crop out regions out of an image and run them independently through a network. You can run the convolutional layers on the full image and then get what you would have gotten at that modular boundary image, right? At that pixel. And the third thing, which if you read the Google Net paper, is this idea of dimensionality reduction. You can view one by one convolutions as trying to do dimensionality reduction. So if this layer, H5 at some point, had 10,000 feature maps, by doing one by one convolutions, I'm taking linear combinations of them, and I get to choose how many such linear combinations I want. If I only want 2, 3, 10, then I've gone from a 10,000 dimensional feature map space to a 3 dimensional feature map space, where every feature map has whatever size it has. Right? So it's doing this dimensionality reduction. And we're going to see all three of these ideas depending on where, what context you're doing.